Hey there, welcome to a brand new episode of Music Express. My name is Twan, and in this week's vlog, you will see my interview with Perry O'Neill about the track Mind Circles, a track which came out in 2003 under the project name St. John vs. Locust. But before we start with the interview, please make sure to subscribe to my channel, and very important, also make sure to click the bell button so you will get a notification the next time a new vlog is online. Alright, here it is, this week's vlog, my interview with Perry O'Neill. Enjoy! Perry van de Vrede is a DJ and producer from the Netherlands. He's mostly known for trance, progressive trance and techno productions under names such as Perry O'Neill, Patch Park, On Off and some others. In the year 2003, his very first ever release came out, which was called Mind Circles, a track he did with UK-based DJ producer John Sims under the name St. John vs. Locust. For this week's vlog, I sat down with Perry to ask him about the story behind this one. My first question to him was, at what age he started to listen to dance music?
I think around the age of 12, 13.
And do you remember some of the tracks that you were listening to back then?
Yeah, I think then was they were releasing compilations with Turn Up the Bass and Turn Up Hip Hop or something. I forgot what's exactly called, but that's what like was the big thing at our school when I was growing up as a teenager. When I was like in first year, second, how do you call it? The next stage after kindergarten, you have secondary school. No, not kindergarten, but two schools after that. It was Turn Up the Bass was huge for us because it was our introduction to. Yeah, to dance music, and we had a lot of older brothers who were listening to. They were going to a very big, well-known place called Parkzicht, and they recorded tapes there. And also, our brothers went to Belgium and recorded tapes there. And then they gave us these tapes, and we were like, "Well, what's this? This is new." And this is how we got into dance music through tapes.
Do you remember some of the tracks that you really liked a lot back then?
We had two kind of worlds. It was or mellow or hardcore, and we were like, not mellow, we want hardcore. It was basically the neophyte stuff and that stuff like that, really, really tough music, and then the more commercial stuff, which was available on CD. So basically stuff like that were either really hard or really commercial. But commercial just, it was released on CD and there was nothing else. There was no streaming, nothing else you can get your hands on. It was tapes, that was the most magical thing. And then a brother came home from a weekend of boozing, and then you had a new tape which you can play with your friends, and then in the afternoon, that was magic.
I think you started with DJing before you started to produce music, right?
Yeah, correct.
So what kind of music did you play?
At first I had one hardcore record. That was, I think, from Roughneck, a very well-known Dutch hardcore producer. And then we went clubbing to that weekend after to, I'll never forget, to Barocci. Was just, we call it a Belgian club, but it was in Zundert, so it's a Dutch club. But they were playing a lot of Belgian DJs, and their sound was there like more mellow and more, like for us it was totally new. And there were a lot of different minded people there. So that weekend we kind of dropped the whole baggage of hardcore and went totally for stuff like Jochen Paap 303. That track was huge then. We instantly shifted towards new kind of music for us, and more like more laid back and more there was not really a style then, and I think it was more techno and early house then.
So when did you start with making music yourself?
Actually around when I was 15 or 16 years old, I bought some hardware, a Yamaha CX-1, I think it's called, a blue one, but what I made sounded like shit. A lot. I didn't make anything I was happy about. I always wanted to imitate Mike, my most favorite producer, Mike from Belgium. But if this sounds like Mike, then my music would never be in the same direction. I was just horrible at it, I think. And I had an Akai sampler and some basic stuff, and really not much happened. So when I was 17, my best friend asked me to go on a vacation. I sold all my equipment and I went to Kos just to drink all the money I sold. And then I did nothing for at least till I was 25, 26. And then,
it's a long break.
Yeah, it's a very long break. But I never lost, because I then invested my money. I bought some turntables because I was into DJing. That I did, but it wasn't until I got my first internship and I got a laptop from my company, and then I could install illegal software just to play around. And that's where, when, I don't need all the expensive setup anymore. I can just buy or download some samples and just go along with one simple MacBook, which I, I don't know what brand it was, but I connected to my hi-fi system and then it was magic, so bleep, bleep, wow. And no more expensive equipment, so it was like a new era for me.
Mm-hmm. So did you have any music lessons before you started with producing?
No, none at all. At school a little bit, but it's more like singing, and I was not really musically teached, no.
Okay. So in the year 2003, your very first ever release came out, Mind Circles, which you did under the name Locust, together with St. John, which is an alias of John Sims. First things first, how did the two of you meet each other?
Well, it's kind of a funny story, because back then I had a website called housedj.com. I wasn't aware of what domain names would be worth later, so I kind of felt, not bad, but I did just deleted the account then. But yeah, via that website I came in, I just mailed DJs, hey, I have a website, can you just check your information if it's correct? And yeah, I started chatting with him because he was interested in also having a website for himself. So I started to make his website and we became friends. It's difficult to say because we never met, but he invited me because he was a DJ Nottingham, in the neighborhood, I've forgotten now. When he's watching this, he'll be probably correcting me, but it's not there. But he invited me basically for a weekend to go along with him to play when he was playing a few gigs, and then we met, and yeah, that's where we started, playing around with Reason on his in his apartment.
So can you tell where the inspiration for Mind Circles came from?
Alcohol. I think it was just I was fooling around after one of the nights he played, and we're just the next day, because he was playing trance tunes, and was like, okay, let's. And we had no keyboard, no MIDI. It was all on with the mouse, because I think the half of my tracks I didn't use a MIDI keyboard. I always used just simple the mouse and a piano roll. Just ping 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 ping. Oh, that doesn't sound right. That's how we did it also. And can you maybe up one that little bit, or maybe transpose a little bit of this? And that's how we made it in a few minutes, I think.
Oh, so it was made in a few minutes time.
Yeah, the melody was very very quickly. But I think the rest of the evening we were just fooling around with getting the rest together, which was in my opinion always the hardest, still the hardest part. The easiest part is once you have the flow, then it starts to happen. Mm-hmm. That went really quickly, but the whole beats and the sounds around it, that took ages, and we actually never finished that.
That was the hardest part of the production.
Yeah.
So what in the studio exactly?
Well, we both worked on, because I was like I wouldn't call it an engineer, but he had never used the program up to the point we installed also on his computer. And we just started working, and then we worked, hey, do you like this? No, maybe you can add a little bit of this. And that's how the track started. I just clicked everything, and he sometimes took over my computer, and then he added something. That's we kind of did it together. Yeah.
Okay, so there wasn't really like a lot of equipment used for the track?
No, a mouse and a laptop.
So how long did it take you to finish the entire track, you think?
The track was really not, it wasn't ready. It was like halfway, half baked, and lots of sounds were missing. So when I was home, I was like, this isn't really what I wanted from the project. So basically I stripped down everything and I held the first like two or three bars from the melody, and then I just changed it a little bit, and then a little bit better, because then I was in my studio, better equipment. Not really actually, because I had a hi-fi system, but it just worked really well for producing. And then I just added some new notes, and basically I kept the first one or two bars, and then I built on it, and then within a minute or so I opened the new patch and I was like, hey, this is a great bass line, and then it happened.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
And how long did that take?
I think an hour or two, three.
Oh wow.
Not longer.
Okay, well, that's pretty quick.
Yeah.
So how did you guys came up with the title?
He did. I just asked him, what would you like for a great title? And he just said, I never forget, he was there beside me. He said, no, I like Mind Circles. What do you think? Ah, sounds cool. Let's do it.
Interesting story.
Yeah, no, there's no deeper deeper layer, no.
So Mind Circles came out via Armin van Buuren's label, A State of Trance. It was actually one of the early releases on the label. Was it easy to get a track signed to A State of Trance?
In hindsight, it was, but at that point it was like I was not really an upcoming producer because I had nothing signed yet. But I was then, back then I was in talks with Lost Language, and I was invited by Bonsai Records, which was like from Mike, my hero was there. So I went there, talked to them, and Airwave walked in, and Yves de Rijder was there also. Because I was also globing to Belgium, and their tracks were playing there for me, was like and then there was Armada just being formed by Michael, and I was like, I don't know these guys, I was not particularly really into Armin because I was more into techno and other stuff, but I was influenced by a lot of music, so it was kind of what should I do. And then actually I was signed almost to Lost Language because they initially picked up the track, but with another not with Mind Circles, but with another song. And then actually Michael called me and convinced me to sign it on a new label with Armada. So I'm in hindsight I'm happy I did that, because nice things happened afterward. But it was kind of it was a month time struggle for me personally where to send the track to. And then eventually Michael, I think he's, if I'm not forgotten, he said no at first, but then a State of Trance happened and I was listening to it and I heard Armin play it on the radio. So I was like, yes, this was already a win. And then I got a text from Michael, we're gonna do it. And I was like, I was set Thursday night, busy student night. I was like, best night ever. And
more alcohol.
Probably. So that was a very cool moment. It was actually from a no to a yes, because they saw the reactions on the internet, also on the track. So that. It's also a thing of taste, and I can sometimes imagine that it, because we were Michael was actually a big influence on my decision making, because my first demo to Armada was like, wow, I can really tell you're a big fan of Mike, but now make something that's really you. And that's the advice he gave me, and that's how Mind Circles came to life.
So is it true that, I think it was Lost Language, they already had the artwork done for the track?
I think I googled it a few weeks back, because there was actually artwork there, and I couldn't find it back in my mailbox, but it was then published on a few websites because it was already posted as a new release. But so it was unless the autograph wasn't signed yet, so I had the contract, the artwork was done, but no release.
oops.
Yeah,
so what happened after the release? Do you remember some DJs that were supporting the track?
Back then I was we come from quite a rural area, is it rural or is it the opposite of quiet?
A busy area?
Not busy, it's very quiet, not a lot of DJs, so we only, we went out a lot, so we didn't listen to radio much, but at that time I was introduced to a State of Trance and the chat, and also I was online that period, and then I get some DJ feedback, and I never saw one of those. It was like, what, 50 names of all these people I know from flyers online. It was like, they're playing my track, what's going on? So that was really, for me already was, mission accomplished at that point, because I had Armin play a track, which was amazing, and then I saw other DJs come in, and that was also, the start that other labels started to approach you if you want to do something for them. And then we came, apparently this is something, because I was really not busy with ego or anything. It was just fun to make music, and then
you were a student, right?
So
just for fun.
It was all for fun. That was the most fun era, was the 2003-2004 era, because everybody was there, talking about music like a group of nerds. There was more than that for me.
So a year later, in 2004, Mind Circles came out with a Perry O'Neill remix from yourself, of course. Why did you decide to remix it already 1 year after the original release?
Because in 2004 I was asked to play a lot more on Armada Nights, they were called. And Mind Circles are really full on trance, and Perry O'Neill was more like proggy trance, progressive trance. Didn't have really that name, I think, back then, because labeled progressive trance then. So I wanted to play it, but Mind Circles 138 BPM, I wanted to play like 132 BPM version. So I just made, it was one of the first Armada Nights at Marcanti Plaza, and I forget, it was, I wanted to play it. So I made a remix just to be able to play the track myself.
Okay. When I checked Discogs, I see that was only one other track that you did as Locust, which was Aerospace, which came out in 2005. But I found something on your old website, and there it says, Perry has also been using the alias Locust for several projects which have a trancy edge. Under his guise, Perry produced his first two tracks, Cubic and Valley of Love. So why did those tracks not come out as Locust at the end?
I think that's again a choice after talking to Michael, who had to have a name for the project, for the vinyl, and yeah, we kind of went with Perry O'Neill from that point on, and yeah, because it was better to keep it separate, because Valley of Love was, yeah, trance, and Cubic was more progressive trance, yeah. So that, and Lost Language wanted to put them together to have something for, you know, for a warm-up and for a peak time set, and Michael thought it was made more sense to keep it more in one genre at that time.
So how important has Mind Circles been for your career?
Difficult to tell, but you know, for me personally, waiting in the mailbox, then my mother like, Perry, called on the stairs, and then have this, you know, a box, and you know it's vinyls in there. Mm-hmm. So you to be able to hold your own vinyl with your name and flipping it and reading, you know, on the artwork and seeing your own name, and just like that was, yeah, for me the most, yeah, that the personally, and after that, yeah, because. I didn't know that Armada would become something so huge. It opened up, of course, doors to people asking for remixes, for collaboration, so that did a lot.
Yeah. So in the credits of Mind Circles, I see you already use the name Perry O'Neill as writer and producer. So why didn't you release this one as Perry O'Neill instead of Locust?
Because I didn't want to pursue a career in trance. I actually wanted to be more progressive, techno, something cool underground, and keep all the trancy stuff on the side as side projects. Yeah, basically to make it clear for bookers, hey, this is my sound.
Yeah, true. Yeah. So after this one, you started to release most of your tracks as Perry O'Neill. In the next interview, we're going to talk more about Wayforce, one of your most well-known Perry O'Neill tracks. But of course, I still have one more question, and that is, pineapple on pizza, yes or no?
Yes, definitely. Yes. Yeah, I like it.
Good. Okay, well, thank you very much for your time, and good luck with everything.
Yeah, thank you, Twan. So, thank you, Twan.
All right, that was it, this week's log. My interview with Perry O'Neill about Mind Circles. Perry, thank you very much for your time. Much appreciated. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed the vlog. If you did, make sure to give this video a like, leave a comment in the comment section below, and make sure to subscribe to my channel. Also, make sure to click the bell button so you will get a notification the next time a new vlog is online. I did another interview with Perry, and in that one we talk about his classic Wayforce. That one should be online soon as well, so keep an eye out for that one. All right, thanks again for watching, and until next time, bye bye.